got so much love, and meeting you so, my love for you I'll never let go. 'Cause I've got so much love, all I want is to hold you. Let me show how much I love you, baby. 'Cause I don't mind. Girl, I love, there's no one above you.
You are the sun, you are the rain
that makes my life this foolish game.
You need to know I love you so,
and I do it all again and again. I've got so much love, and my love, you see, we'll stay together, just you and me. 'Cause I've got so much love, only you want. Tell me how to love you, baby, 'cause I don't mind and I don't mind. Girl, I love, always thinking of you.
You are the sun, you are the rain
that makes my life this foolish game.
You need to know I love you so,
and I do it all again and again.
Oh, oh,
oh, oh.
Good morning, grasshoppers. It's great to see you again for early morning training. We'll be controlling the center, we'll be activating all of our pieces, and we'll be getting our kinks in. And just another reminder not to move the same piece twice unless necessary in the opening. And to place your queen and rooks carefully. Pawn breaks are absolutely essential to opening up lines, to getting your rooks into the game. There is a latent threat to this queen that I'm not entirely sure we're taking advantage of here. Are we recapturing with the rook, or are we capturing? Can we survive this? And the threat is gone. Except there is that danger. Is this a threat? It looks like black has finally taken over with the open lines and the rooks being slightly major pieces. The two major pieces, the queen and the rook. What? You had to recapture the bishop. Oh no, you couldn't recapture the bishop because of the skewer on the file. Exchanging and promoting. The rook takes e7 was a blunder. Now black has his work cut out for him. Bishop d4, rook f6, rook takes c6. Or do we try to sneak back here and get it from a different angle? Personality. And now sneak up on this pawn over here. Uh-oh. I would have saved that until later, perhaps. Were you worried about rook to d3? You had bishop to e5. Rook to f6 threatens mate. How's everyone doing this morning? I have not seen It's Arena Chan streaming lately. Let's give her a quick shout out. She has checked in for the day. She's not saving any VODs, so I don't know the last time that she was streaming. That looks lethal. Winning a pawn. So what happened back there instead of the mating threat? I don't know that there was a defense to the mating threat, was there? Oh no, there was no mating threat because the g4 pawn couldn't move. Never mind. Still a gripping. No, you needed to get those pawns moving. I don't know how you're going to stop this pawn from queening. Your king is not safe. Ouch! That was even better. Exchanging off the rook for pawn promotion. But NCO was on it. Rook to f6 would have lost the bishop because of the pin on the g3 pawn. Good morning, Nico. How are you? Where in the world is Nico Demonius? Let's open up our board a little bit. Alright. I'm staying with non-theory for a little bit until I decide on my absolute course of action with white. I'm going to set a small goal to play 1,000 games with knight c3. I'm only probably at like 300 now. And this way I get to practice my Austrian attack. This was favored by Fischer and his approach against the modern as well. So he's threatening to remove the defender of the center. I want to be able to recapture with the queen. Yes. That looked like it lost a pawn there, sir. It lost a pawn. Small improvement over a previous day's game. The move b5 would be best if there weren't a bishop unprotected on g4. Serbia, I am so jealous. If you are in Belgrade, you should look up the Chess Informant headquarters. See if you can visit the Chess Informant headquarters. And say hello to Ivan or Igor. Or Dusan, who is the editor of the American Chess Magazine, who's doing an amazing job trying to make the American Chess Magazine a rival publication of New in Chess, which is folded. So I don't think New in Chess is being produced anymore. I'm not entirely positive. I'm hoping it is. I have a subscription. All right. I'm skipping that song. Once more. Control the center. Concern yourself with king safety, usually through castling. Don't move the same piece twice in the opening if you don't have to. Develop all of your pieces very actively to the best possible squares. E4, of course, the open game, is the number one way to practice the placement of your pieces. You have to practice playing chess through proper decision making and judgment, which means that the major pieces, the queen and the rook, have to be placed very carefully, otherwise you'll lose a considerable amount of time. Now, was that necessary, that last move? There was a bishop hanging. Oh, so this bishop was hanging. This was hanging. I feel like rook takes c3, d takes c5. And recapturing in this manner and then doubling down on the file would probably be best. But let's take a look. We still have the move, but what does it do now? That knight doesn't have many squares. Ah, so this is an additional threat. An additional threat of e3. We no longer have knight to b1 to guard for two rooks, two pieces for a rook. But the knight on d7 is hanging, so we probably could have blasted through. And everything seems to be held. I have to commend him. He held his d4 pawn. I was going to exchange the d4 pawn. For the pawn on b3. Louis Cooper, ladies and gentlemen. About to double rooks. Alright, we can go for that one. But I'm still concerned about the b7 square as well. Now, do we have anywhere to go? We have to place a rook on the open file. I'm not worried about that pawn, to be honest. I'm not worried about that pawn. You have an outside pass pawn. Right now, we're low on time, and we have to play a good, solid game of chess. Rook to e3 was also possible, but this looks like it wins a piece. This was the loss of a piece. Now trade rooks. Get off of the file, please. No danger, he says. But what was going to happen on rook to b3? Block this way. Making it a lot more difficult for himself. Two pieces for a rook now. Bishop takes a8, rook takes a8, king to g2. f3, king to g2. was a back rank mate. He missed it. Oh no, he didn't miss it. He was threatening it now. Rook takes and rook takes a8. Lee Cooper seems to be out of the worst of it at the moment. But yeah, let's check out Chess Informant. Their address should be there. Certainly if I were able to visit Serbia or even come remotely close, I would probably visit the Chess Informant headquarters. Black really needs a plan now that he's avoided the worst of it. Hey, I got your number. I need to make you mine. This would be a lot easier even for Black to win. Had he exchanged off the bishops with Bishop e4 earlier. Hold on, they've been moving. I got your number on the wall. Now that the pawn is protected on e6, I would probably just go for that one. But it doesn't look good for white, this anchored knight. He built his bridge. Built his bridge. What? F5 was still an option there, by the way. Gonna be a little slowdown in the action here. Rook to g1 would have probably taken care of this a little bit better, but okay. A nice strategic technical win by Lee Cooper. The entire time under 20 seconds. Is the music too loud or is it just right? Checking, checking, checking. Now you should have probably just gotten closer with the king on that last move. King d4. Just box him in. No, rook e3 is the correct technique. Rook e3. Then I get my favorite, walking the king in. Or walking the king around, however you want to look at it. King d2. You don't even need to move the rook after this if you got your king to d2. Oh no, the law way. He had king f3, king f1, and rook back, just with a waiting move. There's no saving that king. It was good enough. His technique was good enough. And now, a word from our sponsor. It's time for Louis Cooper and I to tangle. Always kind of him to move the same pawn twice. I think this is the simplest move. Even though knight c6 is perfectly acceptable. Yeah, this is probably the only way to make this line playable. To be honest. Try to isolate my d5 pawn. Not trying for anything more with bishop to g4. Not trying for more with bishop d4. Fine. Looks like we're going to have to agree to a draw here. We're going to have to agree to disagree on a draw. And now for something completely random. Takes, takes, takes. And thank you very much.
And we're going to move to your number 8 song.
On yeah, we'll go for it.
List. This is a 38 special cut. That's a little bit of a deeper cut for us and really even probably for them.
And did I choose the wrong rook? I don't know. Is it wonderful? Does this work? Let's find out if this works. It only appears to be a threat. It's not really a threat. Yeah, it's probably going to be a draw. There's very little that I can do here. My knight on g6 is absolutely terrible. All right. Can I go for it? It happened so soon. And now for something completely random. Wow. Fine. He did it to me again. Can we attack everything this way? Let's increase the chances of our likelihood. Well, that's kind of you. In a roundabout way. I'm not getting there from here. Keep up the attack. Keeping up the attack. All right, this is unfortunate. I can't get to F1? I can't get to F1 with my knight from here. It's unfortunate. Oh no, that was key. Yeah, that was a bummer. I don't think I had a win there at any point. If anything, I was clearly worse. Clearly, clearly worse throughout that game. What is our text-to-speech up to, I wonder? Knight C3, as advertised. Did not work. It did not work. Well,
oh man, what's that? Wait a second, man. What do you think the teacher's going to look like this year?
What do you think the teacher's going to look like this year? Random voice. Got it bad, got it bad. I'm hot for teacher. Got it bad, so bad. I'm hot for teacher.
Hey, I heard you missed us.
What?
I brought my pencil. Give me something to write on.
What in the world is going on, folks? Takes, 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 and takes. That FS. I thought he might capture with the wrong pawn. I really did think that he was going to catch with the wrong pawn. So bad, I'm hot for teacher. I'm torn. Rip torn.
I think the clock is slow. I don't feel tardy. Class dismissed. Oh yeah. I got it bad, got it bad, got it bad.
I'm hot for teacher. How do I get closer to him without allowing any funny business? we'll find our way. We'll find our way. We'll find our way, find our way, find our way. Oops. Wow, he didn't take? That's craziness. All right, we're winning material again. We went from being down material when he could have taken our knight with the pawn to winning material. Can you believe that? We're taking the active piece. Talking bad, love. Did he not think about that? I need to check that line again. I've been in this position before. Oh, D takes E5, Queen E2. Got it. So yeah, on D takes E5, I was torn on my candidate moves here. Queen E2. Are all the moves good for white? Bishop to B5, check. C6, Bishop C4. Wow. Bishop to B5, check. C6, Bishop to C4, E takes D4, castles. Crazy. I need to see that position. So if takes, then I play bishop takes f7, king e7, rook to e1 check, and I win the queen. Doesn't seem quite so clear to me. You talking about love? All right, fair enough. That one, I learned a new trick about my own favorite opening. Let's play E5 against Mr. R. Cargo, like Magnus Carlsen. Hey. Easily the best of the Fritz Ulfstad variations. Super quiet stream today. We are listed as streaming. That was not necessarily the move that we were planning on seeing. Bishop f1 is normally played instead of bishop takes b5. Can I play it this way? I have to play it this way. Oops. I blundered, folks. I did blunder. Let's give him a checkup. Get a job. Hoping for two pieces for a rook. This might turn out better. This might turn out better. Never change. Them. Just attempting to get my material back. Still down a pawn in this endgame, but a double rook endgame, you never know what you're gonna get. That's just the way it is. That's just the way it is. Let's get active. Getting active. Very unusual. Jesse is a friend. Yeah, no, oh, he's been a good friend of mine. Lately something's changed, it ain't hard to define. Jesse's got himself a girl and I wanna make her mine. We can trade bishops. No, we're not going to trade bishops. I play along with the charade. That doesn't seem to be a reason to change. You know I feel so body, I just know it. Late at night. So the mad physicist is not really here. I'm not present. If you're watching with your volume off, TFS, Parrot, BD Wintergreen, they don't show up as viewers. I'm starting to think that Drops Not is a bot. Speaking queue, event log. Need someone to speak in chat in order to see if this thing works. Connect to Streamlabs. Got it. Knight to C3. Our last bout, perhaps, with Knight to C3 for the day. Let's see if Dr. Masterstein is watching the stream. No, he's not. Otherwise, he would have looked up what to do here. We got a Ruy Lopez with F4 already in. Dr. Mr. Masterstein. This should force some concessions. Well, that's interesting. Let's shift over to the king side, a la peanut butter sandwiches. I'm gonna double that one as well. Well, that was interesting. All right. He's trying to simplify. Let's see how well the simplification works. We're going for the 8-6 pawn. See what happened in that game there. It opened up on the wrong window. Stream elements. How do I connect to stream elements? That is the question. Twitch speaker. I do want to get Twitch speaker. It's a death row pardon. 2 minutes too late. Isn't it ironic? Don't you think? It's like rain on your wedding day. It's a free ride. Oh, it's a YouTube video. MD Night Zero. The lights have gone out on our stream. It could mean that we are closing up shop for the moment, and we'll be back with some instructional videos here on December 6th. Pegasus, good morning. Thank you for the 10 bits. Yeah, I'm trying to set up the text-to-speech in the background, getting distracted. Let's see our car go. I had a relatively effortless run. Is there something to be thinking about? Nico, guard that C4 pawn, sir. Move your rook. What can we do? You've got a winning queenside space advantage, but is it really winning? Just play a whole bunch of moves to gain some time. King G2, King F3, King G2, King F1, King E1, King D2, King C3. You should be okay. That's what we need to do, Nico, is make about 8 moves in a row to give yourself 10 seconds of leeway. And also to catch up on the clock. Run your king over to the queen side. That is where the action is going to be taking place. Maybe. Maybe you have A5. He's going to try to lock it up and the tension will be built. What can be done? Looks like it should be a draw, ideally. Don't see any way in. I don't see any way in. that one side or the other opening up lines. The h4 pawn is a little bit of a weakness. Bishop c3, bishop e1, g5 check. f3, g5 check. King h2. I don't know. Whoop, he did it. He followed that plan. He gained 10 seconds on the clock. But now, how do we break through? The king comes in. No, you got the king coming in on e4. Not that it can do anything, though. Wow, he let it come in. Make the most of freedom and our pleasure. Yeah, we don't have anything. It's unfortunate. Was there anything back here? Hold on, right here. Knight takes e4. We were in danger here. We were certainly in some danger. But being a pawn up, there was not anything he could do about it. Not bishop f3, allowing g4. G4 to lock things up. We're still worse without g4, though. And then black misses taking the pawn, and that's where we came in. Oh no, we came in after this. And the pawn was hanging. Could be time for an exchange sacrifice, but what would it do? There's no breakthrough. I wonder what the exchange sacrifice would do. Would it do anything? Alive in this game up? C takes d5, they really want us to play, and then c4 sacks the pawn, and then the rook gets the open file. Nice work. Nice work, Nico. Congratulations on a solid second place ahead of our cargo. That was key. That was a key draw for the positioning. So the sound alerts, I have to figure out the API token for Streamlabs, and I don't know that I can connect to them offline.
So now we're trapped in Fisher's mind battling his own private army.
Oh no.
We'll be lost in limbo till our brains turn to scrambled eggs.
Welcome, Grand Mistress Iron. Welcome. Welcome, welcome. Indeed. You need a good raid emoji. I'll give you one. Which was made for me by Quatris Spassky, by the way. Let's give Grandmistress Iron a shout out. How was your stream? Make sure I spell it right. Otherwise, it's all for naught. I am PDA trainer, National Master John MacArthur. I was very lucky in this particular arena. I played Knight C3 three times. And often, I don't know why, my opponents respond with G6 or something really lame. Not unlike this. But actually, I wanted to check to see how many times I've played Knight C3 in the player.
I missed something. Can you say
Alexa,
it again?
Stop. So yeah, last I was looking up Penguin GM, you can actually look up various players as white. All set in the lead chess database. I don't know if you thought about that, but you could actually look up anyone as white or as black in the lead chess database. Nice. Were you playing viewers? I'm gonna turn down the music a little bit, unless it's too loud for you. Is it too loud for you? I only have it in the one ear and it's quite loud. Were you playing viewers? I'm John, by the way. I don't know if you've ever given out your first name, Grand Mistress Ira, but I like the GM Iron idea. I can't even recall. I know I'm already following you. Was last been playing Flirt. Nice. Nice. I had never heard of this game, Flirt. I like it. And you're a fan of volcanoes as well. Oh, I love volcanoes. Yeah, but what I mean is, I can only play games in the course of an arena or a tournament. I can't just get on games and play, just play a chess game. Like when people want to play you a chess game. Iron sounds very Celtic. I'm probably mispronouncing it. Iron. I like it. I like it a lot. And you are not from Iceland. Although you're currently in Germany. Iceland is one of my favorite places that I've visited. I loved the streets and the low-key casual environment of Reykjavik, and I didn't really get out of Reykjavik. I didn't get to the Blue Lagoon. I wanted to get to Fisher's Grave. I see that. I looked you up just in case I was wrong. I'm a terrible Twitch stalker, absolutely terrible. You might be able to help me out in that respect, but in general, I am. You don't have any of your socials on your page, or do you? Maybe I'm not seeing it. Usually you can post them up as those are my socials. Definitely connect with me so we can work on your chess game. I don't know that your chess game needs work. I apologize if that's not the case. But I do chess for a living 24/7. I am usually leaving right about now. Alexa, turn on Dojo. I am usually leaving right about now to teach sunrise chess, but this is one of a few days where I go in late and they happen to be in a row. I'm quite enjoying because tomorrow I leave for the District of Columbia, Washington, D.C. In National Harbor, we have our National School Grade Championships. So everyone from kindergarten through seniors or the last year of high school, secondary school, preparatory school, will be playing. And I'm looking forward to it. I haven't looked at the list, but usually we have about 30 plus kids going from our school. And one of those was Hans Niemann in the past. Yes, Hans Niemann went to my school. We got him about or after the age of 16, so we did not get to experience the Hans Niemann that everybody vilifies. And he did have quite the potent personality. which I quite enjoyed. That is the type of personality that you need to reach the top. You need to be abrasive a little bit. You need to be slightly disrespectful, and you need to be able to pave your own path in order to get to the top of the chess world, or get to the top of anything, really. But as I reminded my students, I have one... Oh, no! I'm sorry to hear that. Yeah, I know, I hate that when I'm... Let's say I click away from the window for a moment by accident, and then I think I'm typing, and then they didn't type. But I definitely got you from Iceland. You're obviously more than likely from Reykjavik. I'm watching a number of television shows based in Iceland. I'm trying to think of what the one on Netflix is that I'm watching now with the heavyset detective and the police force. And they're going constantly between Reykjavik and the islands and whatnot. Drawing a blank. I think it begins with a D. Short of bringing up my Netflix, I don't know that I can recall it. But definitely connect with me on my socials. I will always take a message. Really? That's even better. That's even better. No, I love your look. I wish I had a cool look. I thought about coloring my hair or doing something like Amon Hamilton does, but I'm just me. No, I really actually thought, based on the number of Irish immigrants, I'd look great with purple hair too. I'll consider it. I have considered purple hair. The problem with most colors is that you have to bleach your hair to get some colors. And then we'd be matching, actually, if I put a purple wave across, right? So, I have one absolute grandmaster to my name. Even though I've taught and tutored a lot of other titled players and given advice to guys like Fabiano Caruana and Robert Hess, because I knew them all at the same time. I was very lucky because they all grew up in the same era when I really reached my peak in training and teaching chess for the most part. Yeah, it's not to be recommended, right? The hair takes a beating when you bleach it. That's fancy indeed. But yeah, in general, so the school has two grandmasters to date and one international master. One of our students just now, Nico Chasen. Nico Chasen just became an international master. I think it'll be confirmed in the next Congress. I think he missed the November Congress. So we have three titled players, and we're working on more. We have a lot of very strong young students coming out of our school. But Hans Niemann, as I follow Vishy Anand in the respect, unless I can prove it, has not cheated over the board. It takes an incredible amount of effort to cheat over the board. And that same effortlessness that Magnus Carlsen reached, for example, I can do four or five things while playing a chess game. It's a lot how streamers do it. We are very casual and we win our games. And because Magnus Carlsen accused Hans Niemann of being too casual when he was being beaten, he took offense to it. And I think he had had it planted in his head previously that since he'd... Nice. You should get a title. Absolutely. Let's check out, is your name Grandmaster Siren on Lee Chess? I'm just going to type it in and see what I get. Oh, Nurieva. Yes, I actually saw that on the stream when I poked my head in to see your last video. So you prefer D4 as white. I'm not going to go into detail because I don't want anybody... And you win 1 out of 3 games, which is okay. That is exactly what's expected. I remember when one of my students asked me how I got a positive score, because I have more wins than I do losses. And she's like, John, how do you get more wins than losses? And I said, you just have to keep improving, and slowly you will actually get over the hump. It depends on where your percentages are. So against E4, you seem to have a little bit of a weakness. Yeah, E4, though, is the fastest way for improving so that you can learn how to place your pieces and coordinate your pieces best. Interestingly enough, if you want to reach the highest of heights in chess, it's all about piece coordination. I can see countless numbers. I saw an opening recommendation yesterday by... It wasn't chop to chop. I started watching someone after chop to chop yesterday. And they were recommending this really convoluted line that leads to an advantage, which they were absolutely correct. It is an advantage. It might even be close to winning. But for the average player to coordinate their pieces in this very strange position, it would be not so easy. The only thing you could hope for is that your opponent doesn't know how to coordinate their pieces. The only problem with that position was that it was the queen in exchange for a couple of rooks. And the queen in exchange for a couple of rooks, and the rooks were very oddly placed. So yes, the side with the rooks and the bishop versus the queen had an advantage, but believe it or not, everyone does not know how to play against E4. For example, you like to play everything. I love it. Absolutely love it. It looks like you play the Scandinavian the most, and that's a typical example of how people do not know how to play against E4. I find that they don't know how to play against the Carl Kahn. The Carl Kahn is lacking in your repertoire, for example. But basically, when I play the Carl Kahn, I would say 2 out of 3 opponents play E5, and this makes it, once again, very difficult for white to coordinate their pieces if they don't have an inherent... I don't blame you. No, you should keep moving on. But after the move c5, as I saw played by Naroditsky against Nemo, aka Nemsko, Danya played c5 and just took over the center, and this is usually my recipe as well. And then black just coordinates his pieces to very natural squares, depending on what he gets. That's a very good French defense, basically. So this fits in with their original, when I started the stream, mantra of not moving the same piece twice. Basically, even Bobby Fischer never played the advanced variation. He either played e takes d5, followed by bishop d3, or followed by c4, attacking the d5 square. Or, against Petrosian, I have an instructive stream coming up. I was planning on shutting down and restarting the stream so that I could show games that were gifted to me by viewers. The Unstoppable American was gifted to me through my Amazon wish list. And you should definitely set up an Amazon wish list for yourself. Set up an Amazon wish list for things that you need for your stream, and your viewers will often provide them. I don't really need anything necessarily because I bought a house during COVID, moved out of Manhattan. I'm from New York City, obviously. I lived in Manhattan for 3 decades. Not concurrently. I moved to Queens and then back to Manhattan. I had moved to Brooklyn briefly and then back to Manhattan. And I was basically in Manhattan for about 3 decades. And I love the convenience of not having to drive anywhere. I don't know what part of Germany you are in, but I know the only part I've been to is Frankfurt. If I were able to visit Hamburg, I would visit the chess base headquarters. Oh no! Let's see what can be done.
No more foreplay.
There we go. We took care of that. We broke your, as another viewer put it, here's my favorite one. I don't know if you know Irina Chan. She came in the other day. It was absolutely hysterical. If I could find that one. She said, she put this one up.
Closing parenthesis. My first sub ever to someone. You took my virginity.
That was pretty hysterical. That was probably the best, let's just say the most unforgettable subscription message ever, as far as those things go. But in general, yeah, you want to develop your pieces as rapidly as possible, and I do believe that knight c3 is the best move against the Kao Kahn. If you do run into people who don't take on e4, then it's probably recommended that you play knight to d2, because then d takes e4 is somewhat forced. Everything leads to a disadvantage for black. And from this position, you get to play a very forced line and all of that, so you really don't have any problems. And Chessable, whom I sometimes sponsor, by the way, they haven't given me anything in a while, so therefore, I haven't been promoting them as much. If you're not on Chessable, don't sign up for an account. Do not sign up for an account. E4, D4. Yeah, against everything. If your opponent answers with E6, D4. If they answer with D6, D4. And if they answer with anything at all, C6, then you're playing D4. The only time that you cannot play D4 on the second move, and this is very serious, are against two particular moves. The Scandinavian, but you can play d4, actually. That leads to a Blackmar Demer Gambit, which is quite a lot of fun. And I have played that against the Scandinavian. Or against the Alucard. This one you really cannot play the move d4, unfortunately. The Omega Gambit. That's quite crazy. I did not know that this had the name Omega Gambit. And someone did play this against you, and you won against them. Nicely done. Blueprints NY, who might have been a new viewer. Your game went. So they're trying to play in Blackmar Demer style. You know, that would be the case, because normally the pawn in the declined version would be shoved to e3. So getting back to our original Blackmar Demer assessment, right? If white plays the move f3, this is commonly played. But black has an open d file here, and in your game, there's still a D pawn on the board, so that makes it a little bit, yeah. I would certainly be signing up if I needed to get an account to play against you, absolutely. I would sign up on Lee Chess. I'm not a huge fan of the ads and the promos and the commercialization of chess.com, unfortunately. I just feel like unless I'm getting paid to push their ads, I don't want to do it. And most people aren't getting paid. Oh no, not... I should have warned you about the link. Hold the phone. Let me just head up there to bring you back. Because I will not believe your eyes. Sorry about that. That's why I have it on the stream, on the screen. Believe it or not, you love that. That's good. No, I like to have the stuff on the screen below my camera. Like, for example, your camera placement and sizing is perfect, right? And mine is perhaps maybe a little too small and a little bit too rectangular because I'm showing off the room a little bit. These are all chess books for the most part. I'll throw up an intermission screen so you can see the rest of my rather cluttered room. So I have the same note. I have two bookcases on every wall, all filled with chess books that are be used for training. So on this side, to my left, these are all general subject books arranged by author. On this side, on the right side of me, we have all the world champions and top players in the first bookcase. And in the following bookcase, we have 2.5 shelves of endgame books, tournament books, and match books like Botvinnik's World Championship or Zurich 1953. We have combination and tactics books and Encyclopedia Chess middle game tactics. And toward the bottom, on the bottom shelf of that far one, we have generic fluff like the excellent book. If you haven't read Jennifer Shahadi's book, Chess Queens, it is a great read. Chess Queens by Jennifer Shahadi. And then of course behind me, which everybody sees, are the two bookcases of collections. There's some collections books like New in Chess Yearbooks and Chess Informant. I'm a big fan of Chess Informant. That was the book that primarily helped me become a master. And if you need to know more about Chess Informant, I included an article from chessbits.com, which I hope is still current. Just checking, yes. They replaced the picture of Fischer? No, they have Fischer there. They have all the world champions, including Carlsen. Almost everyone has benefited from Chess Informant in one way or another. Chess Informant was the original impetus for ChessBase, the automated program that I use for training. So needless to say, the top two shelves are collections, and then starting on the third or fourth shelf going across, those are all opening books. There's only one shelf of opening books over here. I think it's the fourth one. But all of them are by opening, going across. And I'm probably going to ship my Chess Informants to school because I have to do that. Have you done any collaborations to work on your chess? I'm surprised if anyone has not scooped you up, because you're a catch. You're a real catch. I wouldn't doubt if Chess Nerd, but most of them, unfortunately, I think the main benefit for you is most of them are enslaved to chess.com. Like, they're not allowed to stream or play on any other platform because they signed a contract with chess.com, which insures them no money. The vast majority of streamers are insured no money. There are a few guys that, of course, that require money. Like Hikaru, I'm sure, gets some money for the ads. After all, he's building their platform, or he gets a percentage of the subscriptions of the to chess.com. Whoever comes from him with his code. No way! Now there we go. It would both be our first times. My worst fear is that I wouldn't know how to do it. By the way, I do not fully teach chess. I want to throw this warning out. I do not teach chess to be a dry technical improver where you do not get to have any fun. I do recommend all of the fun openings even the ones such as Eric Rosen might purport. Even though I know it's a bad opening, there are a lot of openings that you have only one small window in to have fun and learn. It's like children on the recess yard. As we get older, right, we don't get any recess time in the playground. So we have to schedule our own recess time in the playground. But needless to say, most people don't schedule it well for themselves. But learning through play and having fun is the key ingredient. And experimenting with new openings, for example, it's Arena Chan who subscribed with her creative message, for example. She's very strong, and she also loves to play a lot of gambits. You play the London against them. So I have some drawbacks with the London, because the London gets you into this habit of playing the same moves over and over again, and it doesn't really reward your creativity and just looking, just observing you for the most part. I have a feeling that you may appreciate the opportunities to be more creative and stretch yourself as a player, however you choose, for the most part. I'll make sure my sound isn't on. There we go. Make sure my sound is off when I peruse. Needless to say, you know, it's not about memory, though. You don't have to remember any openings if you understand them. I would like you to play chess the same way that you breathe, the same way that you choose a restaurant to eat in the evenings on a Friday or a Saturday evening. You know, you have a few choices, and your cravings will take you in that direction. No, you're doing excellently if you're breaching 1300. That's super. I would say definitely join the Discord if you get a chance. No, the gambits involve absolute activity, throwing your pieces into the center, coordinating your pieces, and that's what it's all about. You can do it. Thank you for joining the Discord. Namaste. Our Discord is not super active, so you don't have to worry about muting it. So yeah, I'm gonna promise you, chose no warrior. Welcome, namaste. I know I'm actually streaming past my usual recommended closing time. You beautiful bastard. I've never met chose no warrior in person, but I'm going to take GM Irun. Trying to figure out how to pronounce it. Irun. I'm going to go with Irun for now. Until I will out my Icelandic translator. Yes. I'm going to take her word for it. Absolutely. No, I would love a routine and regular collaboration, because you're the perfect person as an improving player, and I want you to have fun every step of the way. You absolutely must just throw your stuff at it. For example, and of course we also have to work on piece coordination and the powers of each and every individual piece for the most part. I hope that you've done all of the chess basics. You should absolutely do all the chess pieces. Even though I disagree with a lot of these, Thank you for following, Bladner. Oh, one. Namaste. Ah, that's correct. If you have a coach, I'm not going to tell you anything that he wouldn't. I would hope, ironically. But the thing that I worry about when, let's just say you're getting accommodated, is that sometimes coaches tell you what you want to hear. So here's the tricky part about me as a professional coach, and I've learned this over the years. I try not to just tell students what they want to hear. There's so many coaches out there. So let's say you're paying me for lessons, right? You're paying me for lessons. And if I have to tell you something that is the cold, hard truth, this is why I like chess coach Andres Toth, then I have to either doctor that up in a way that may or may not be absolutely to the point and keep you as a customer for the most part, as a paying student. But these are not lessons. My lessons, for example, as part of a collaboration, in general, they are never charged for. Most people, and in fact, I don't believe that many of the collaborators ever charge somebody else for the lessons, but I don't know that for a fact. And when I tell that to the chess.com streamers, I immediately lose them to Donya or somebody else. So what can you do? Yeah, but I do believe in this. And the main thing is that you have to actually choose how to do the pieces in the correct order. Now, if you have a touch screen, I also highly recommend that. Now, the first two are always pretty easy, but now we're going to be confronted with some choices. We now have to choose whether or not we're going to e6 or d5. And going to e6 or d5 is a very serious problem, right? So if we're going to capture all of these stars in order, we can't just set off like this, because now we're left in limbo. And you might be surprised at this just basic thing. I love this drill. This was done by another teacher. Now, if you need to redo them, all you have to do is click on it again. So if you just click on the one star, then you can actually correct your pattern, etc. We can move on to the next one. It becomes incrementally harder until you get to the last one. And these are just basic ones, and I would time myself just to try to work it out and come back to it every now and then just for fun. And I would definitely do it on stream as well for speed, because this is a key tool in developing for the most part. I think this one is very misleading, what I remember. I think you have to go out. Oops, I took a guess, right? And I didn't make it. So we'll go to the other one and we'll go back. So it's obviously the inside. We can map it out, right? Using notation, we can map it out. So we're going to go d5, e3, f5, e7. This has to be the last one. That has to be the last one, because we can't get to anything from here. That has to be the last one. So this is the second to last one, perhaps? Yep. So I was on the right path. I just went in the wrong direction. And then when you get to the others, for example, you're going to have one for en passant as well, by the way. So you can practice en passant captures. And this way you get to practice en passant captures. We don't have this option because this pawn is already too far advanced. But when a pawn moves two squares, I call it an illegal move. This is an illegal move because we know that pawns only move one square at a time. Yeah, but this is a great drill in the learn section to do as a warm-up for your stream or in general, because this is the best place to do it. So I consider en passant an illegal move. We know that pawns can only move one square at a time, and allowing them to move two squares creates an illegal opportunity, right? So now if your opponent makes the illegal move against you, what happened to your right to capture him? Now we have to create a whole new illegal move just to deal with the fact that we let somebody get away with an illegal move, right? You get to capture those. It's like a tennis ball machine, if you've ever faced a tennis ball machine, right? And you can actually avoid stalemate, create stalemate. You have to find the stalemate, right? To stalemate black, black cannot move anywhere. Oh, yes. We just have to cut him off there. I guess the local over-the-board tournament. Why it's legal, I know. It is overtly illegal. So therefore, I am coming with you to common ground. The common ground is that it is an illegal move. But remember, on the very first move of the game, we were already allowed one illegal move. We were allowed to move a pawn two squares. And then suddenly, a little while later, we have to deal with somebody not letting us capture them because we allowed this illegal move. So shouldn't I get an illegal move too? If they get an illegal move, so I get an illegal move too to capture it. Just like that. I get an illegal move too just to capture it. And I love this tennis ball machine one. Literally every pawn. He didn't know that I could take his pawn. I think you got tooken, Nico. I think he definitely knew what en passant was, and he decided that he was going to gamble and then claim that he didn't know what was going on. I think you got tooken. Drunk chess. Why the stalemate rule? I agree with you, and I think it was discussed on Fabiana Caruana's C-Squared podcast recently. You know, I'm going to switch our music up to something a little bit less lively. How about that? I'm debating switching the music up to something a little less lively so that we can talk without having the pumped up, we're ready to checkmate our opponent's sounds in the background. Hopefully this is less lively. No, I had a... You don't think he was such a good actor? I had an opponent at the Manhattan Chess Club. I don't know if it was 1989 or 1990, but I was definitely new to New York. And he's at the board, and he's like doing this with the notation. He's going out to the F, and he's doing this. On every move, he's going F, 6, knight, F6, and then this, and this, and this. And it was so painstaking to watch him go through this routine, which was overacting in a way, that I eventually made a mistake and I blundered something. I think I blundered, I don't know if I blundered a piece, but I definitely blundered something that, like an exchange perhaps. And then he became instantly good. Illegal move happens over the board. Yeah, we don't get illegal moves on Lee Chess or whatever. You're just not allowed to make them. But yeah, then suddenly he's Mr. He's not even looking at the score sheet when he writes down his perfect score. He's just making his move, writing down the score sheet, making his move, writing down the score sheet, making his move, writing down the thing. And I was completely taken, and he was about 300 rating points lower than me. And I lost the game. And I was just so perturbed with him. It was very, very funny. He was from somewhere else. He wasn't from New York City. He was just visiting the club. He was playing in the the four rated games that happens every Thursday night. Also happens to this day at the Marshall Chess Club in Greenwich Village. Yeah, so I completely got taken. And so every time I hear a story like yours, Nico, I think, yeah, right. Like, was he really bamboozled? But I agree with you that people don't know about it or don't recognize it. So a friend of mine, Mike and I were very good friends, and we traveled to so many tournaments together. I think we were playing in Kansas City, Missouri, and he had gone to the bathroom, and his opponent played a move with his pawn that allowed en passant by Mike. Mike could play e takes f6. I think it was f5. I'm not entirely sure, but I think it was f5. And when Mike plays e takes f6, the whole king side of the guys is destroyed. Like, the guy's just going to be destroyed. My game was in a town with less than 5,000 people. Yeah, I agree. Exactly. Hatton Chess Club. Hustlers, I tell you, hustlers. So, yeah, I look to my left, and Mike could do it, but he comes back from the bathroom, and then Mike digs down into deep thought, and I'm like looking at Mike like, my God, he didn't actually see the F-pawn move two squares. So I don't think it's registering for him that the pawn came from F7 as opposed to F6. Matt, quick chess in the house. Drunk chess. A guy in my club gave me a score sheet. First move for white was d7, d5. But every score is notated. Yeah, the board was upside down, and he was reading the notation each move exactly. All 1e4. Good morning. MQC in the house. And for those of you who have not yet followed Grandmaster Iron, we're going to get over 1K subscribers by the end of the week. What is this? Oh, I went all the way back. Where did your shout out go? I take it back. I must have overwritten it. Please follow Grandmaster Iren. I have to remember to, and she is quite the flirt. I like it. She should be chatting more often. We're gonna do something about that. She's gonna work on my skills as well. So for the most part, yeah, I could understand that the board being backwards is, but as long as you're, I mean, I don't even look at the board letters and numbers. I have so many boards in my office here that do not have notation on the side of them. All right. So let's work on the next three levels. Basically, there are teachers, there are trainers, and there are coaches. And for the first good portion, because you mentioned that you already have a coach, basically. This will be an online work for the most part. It has nothing to do with your regular coach. You should not give up your regular coach. You should definitely get a second opinion on everything that I say. And he should not, or she should not, feel encroached upon. That's the number one thing that I don't want him to think that I'm stealing you, even though anybody else could think that. No, it helps to have the in-person coaching. So you have three levels of coaching. You have teaching for the absolute fundamentals, and then you have coaching, which works on all levels. For example, when I go to Baltimore, as in FIDE. Hold on, Andrew. Bad quick chess, Andrew. Basically, yeah, no, there are three levels. And it wasn't really until 2016 that I really made this distinction for myself, because I realized that I wanted to be a trainer. And I had done training before. I just hadn't done on a regular basis. So I went for my FIDE training certification. So the difference between teaching and coaching is that basically you can be mentoring somebody. Let's just say Grandmaster Mark Arnold, right? When he was stronger than me, I was coaching him. Like we traveled to four tournaments. We worked on recommendations for openings. We didn't necessarily go into details. It's a lot like a lot of coaching involves, you know, you're having a little bit of difficulty in complex positions versus simple technical positions, or wild positions versus simple technical positions. Maybe for this next tournament, you should switch up or consider a different opening system. That would be coaching. Coaching in general, honestly, can get into details. Absolutely can get into details, and you will be working one-on-one with somebody to work out and iron out those details. But you can be a coach for someone and not be their regular person, right? So I had Grandmaster William Lombardi working with Mark Arnold, and I had Grandmaster Joel Benjamin working with Mark Arnold, but that didn't stop me from seeing them once a week. Yes, Bill Lombardi. And on my Facebook story, I have to highlight that when I went to Little Poland Restaurant in the Greenwich Village and the East Village and celebrated with some of his friends. I celebrated with some of his friends the birthday of Bill Lombardi on Sunday. I don't remember if I won the Bill Lombardi tournament on Sunday. I have to go back and just take a quick peek. Did I win the Bill Lombardi tournament on Sunday? No, this is Master Chess Dojo. Master Chess Dojo, Rapid and Classical. By the way, Irun, I recommend that you play in an accountable environment for your improvement. I love the fact that you play rated games. In fact, the fact that you play rated games makes your opponents accountable against cheating. Because when you play a casual game, honestly, let's just say you and I are playing a casual game, then I expect you to do everything in your power to improve your ability at the board, because there's no price. These games do not matter. And unfortunately, these things are construed as in the Hans Niemann case, where he didn't think the casual games matter. I agree with him. When you're playing randomly casual games with a friend, and you both want to look up, let's just say we use the ECOB up there, and we look up the moves to improve our openings, that's perfectly acceptable for people to look up opening moves. Lombardi's birthday. You can tell that I've been doing these tournaments since time immemorial, every single day. I did win the Bill Lombardi birthday event. Nice. I have not been winning lately. Bill Lombardi was a truly great individual. His claim to fame, well, he had two or three claims to fame. Number one, he was Bobby's mentor and coach throughout much of his life. He was Bobby's mentor and coach all the way up into the 1972 World Championship. And in the 1972 World Championship, he got a cold. And as Andrew just pointed out, he had a perfect score. I think it was the 1957, yes, the only tournament to win the World Junior Championship with a perfect score. Interestingly enough, I only saw a couple of his games in his book, Understanding Chess, My Life, My Games, My System. Understanding Chess was a self-published book. All right, Irun, that's great. No worries. I'm going to let you guide the raid. Where should we go from here, Grandmistress Irun? Please join the dojo as well, if you haven't already. Join the Rapid and Classical for the Slow Chess on weekends. It's 8 a.m. I don't know. It's 4 o'clock. No, it's 2 o'clock in the afternoon for you, maybe. Elmar's Chess. Good morning. How are you doing? Let's give Chop to Chop the raid, because I like his attitude. What a drunk chess say. One second, I missed it. I heard Lombardi once when sealing a move in a lost position. That does sound like him. I could see him doing that. Bouncing across. Yes, I like bouncing across as well, but he's not streaming chess. He's doing just chatting. So bouncing across has been here, by the way. He recognized me yesterday with a shout out, but I haven't raided Chop to Chop in a while. In fact, I think it was Bouncing Across who may have told me that statement earlier that we were talking about when I said it wasn't Chop to Chop. It was Bouncing Across whom I went to afterwards. But I am coming back. I want to do it. By the way, Andrew, I don't know if you're friends with Bruce Pandolfini. He was at the dinner the other night. Bruce Pandolfini said that he wrote something on Facebook about Pandolfini's 1957 World Junior run. No, but on Facebook. I don't know if you were connected on Facebook. If you could look him up, you might be able to find him among my friends on Facebook. I'm never on Facebook. So if he hadn't told me, I'm never ever on Facebook. But if he hadn't told me, he wrote that up. Have a great day, Grandmaster Siren. We're going to give her another shout out just now. First chess book you owned. That's very cool. Which one was it? Which one was it? Reinfeldt wrote the first chess book. I don't know if he's on Instagram, but I'm gonna share it. I'll tell you what, I'm gonna share the post with you. I'll share an image of the post with you on Instagram through a message, through a DM, if I find it. I just have to remember for myself to go to Facebook more than once a month. I've lost it now. Oh no, but I can list all the Pandolfini books for you. You might remember. Chess Weapons, Outrageous Chess Moves of Bobby Fischer. The Outrageous Chess Moves of Bobby Fischer was a great book. I love that one a lot. I want to give Grandmistress Iron a shout out before we go. And before our raid ends, I need to run the ending credits. And if we don't make it, I'm hoping we can. Matt Quick Chess in the house. Everyone follow Matt Quick Chess and GM Iron. Bladner, thank you for the follow. Cheers and ciao, everyone. Thank you so much. Matt Quick Chess, thank you for the bits. Master Cheers. 845 idea.